Simon & Schuster Audio presents Who Killed the Fonz? A novel by James Boice. Read by Michael Crouch. Sunday. Nothing was moving on the 405. Richard sat at the wheel, scanning the Corvette's radio dial, looking for some kind of news about the jam, but there was nothing. He looked at the clock again. Couldn't be late. On the radio was Prince. It was his daughter's favorite. He himself wasn't sure about all that innuendo and raunch. He wasn't sure about much these days. He had seen the film that Prince had starred in and had liked it more than he thought he would. He had expected a 2-hour music video, but it was a drama about family and love and what it meant to pursue your dreams, what it cost. His friend Stephen had made him watch it, called him over to his private theater in his house. It had been nice of Stephen to call. It had been months, maybe longer. At one point, he asked Richard what he had been working on. All he had to do was tell him about his project. Stephen would have helped him. All he had to do was say the words. But Richard couldn't tell him. He muttered that he was tinkering with a few different things, then changed the subject to the new project Stephen was executive producing, a time travel film with the kid from Family Ties. He and Stephen had started out around the same time. They were part of a crew of hustlers, strivers, doing whatever they could to make films. Spielberg, Scorsese, Lucas, Cunningham. Back then, they all thought it would be Richard who would be the one inviting them over to his private movie theater one day. He had been the first to sell a script, first to get an Oscar nomination. Now almost all of them had become directors on a first-name basis with the world. And he was just another no-name chump stuck in traffic on the 405, running late to lunch with his agent, who held the fate of his project in his hands. He steered the Corvette down Sunset. The clock said he was okay on time. He relaxed, his mind wandering. He wondered yet again whether or not his agent wanting to meet on a Sunday meant good news. Lori Beth and his mother warned him not to get his hopes up. He could not help it. If the news was bad, legendary Hollywood agent Gleb Cooper would not waste his time with a face-to-face, especially not on a Sunday. Richard had a good feeling. This would be the day he had been waiting 3 years for. He passed Book Soup, where it had all started. He had been browsing the bargain bins when he came across a remaindered copy of a bizarre-looking novel. Black dust jacket, no art. Just the title and the author's name in big, elaborate font that seemed taken off the side of a 19th-century circus wagon. It was the black-and-white author photo that most intrigued Richard. Most of them posed very self-seriously, bloodless Ivy Leaguers in tweed. This one, however, named Cormac McCarthy, wore jeans, denim jacket, had uncombed hair. The look on his face was surprised, like someone had shouted his name and snapped his photo when he turned around. He looked like he couldn't figure out what he was doing on the back of a book jacket. In the background, there was not a prestigious college campus or the slick Manhattan skyline, but an industrial town. Smokestacks, a bridge, a shipping channel. It looked like the same kind of town Richard had come from. He took the book to the register. The clerk gave him an approving nod, a good sign. That night at home, he started reading. He could not stop. 3 days later, he was still reading. He would have finished the book sooner, but the language was like nothing he had ever seen outside of Shakespeare. It was almost something physical to grapple with. He kept having to put the book down and reach for the dictionary. Concatenate, leptosome, electuary. They were not even words. They were portals to new worlds. The story's grip on Richard was just as mysterious. A man lived on a houseboat in Knoxville, Tennessee, in the 1950s. He seemed to have come from a prestigious family, but had been somehow alienated or cast out. A sordid cast of fringe-dwelling characters wandered in and out of his life, pulling him into their small-time hustles and drunken misadventures. Not much happened on the outside. But on the inside, in the heart and mind of this man, named Sutri, as he tried to hold on to his sense of self in an ever-changing world bent on taking it from him, everything was happening. Everything. Richard understood right away that he knew this character, felt like he had known him all his life. He could not say why. Not since he was a teenager had he felt this way about a book. Something about this novel brought him back to that vulnerable, open-hearted place he had been when he was young, and he wanted desperately to hold on to it. Richard did not know why this character was so appealing to him. Because with Richard's sports car and slick suits and Spanish colonial and Sherman Oaks with a pool and detached mother-in-law bungalow in back, he and Sutri would not seem to have a lot in common. He certainly wasn't a drinker like Sutri. In fact, he rarely drank. Not since one night long ago when he was a young father and the pressure got to him. He took it too far that night and never made that mistake again. But that was what made the book so powerful. It was a kind of art he had never encountered before. The kind that would seem to have nothing to do with you, yet still gets to you in ways art that has everything to do with you does not. When he closed Sutri after the final page, he saw the whole thing in his head. The film adaptation he would make of this novel. He saw it from the opening theme through the end credits. I am going to make it, he told himself. He looked at the cover, then the author photo. He felt a warmth growing in his chest. His fingers and hands filling with blood, like they had been asleep but were now waking up. I am. He had to make this film. He was going to write it, and he was going to direct it. It would be his directorial debut. Not only that, it would be his triumphant return from the brink of extinction. It was a strange choice of restaurant. Typically, his meetings with Gleb Cooper took place at Musso and Frank, where Gleb had a booth they'd clear out for him upon his arrival, and the maitre d' would accommodate his every need. Once, Gleb had ordered catfish. The menu did not include catfish. But Gleb wanted catfish, and Gleb got catfish. Richard could not imagine how they located and prepared one so quickly, but it arrived on time with Richard's steak tartare. Richard would try to discreetly eyeball the luminaries filling the surrounding tables without Gleb noticing, because if he caught his companion's gaze wandering like that, he took it as an insult, a challenge, and he would not let it go. He would hold on to it for the rest of the meal. And he would mention it at every meal after. But Richard would tell his grandchildren about that day at Musso's when Warren Beatty came over to their table to shake Richard's hand, because, Warren Beatty said, he had just heard from a friend at the Academy that Welcome to Henderson County was going to be nominated for an Oscar, and he wanted to shake the hand of the man who had written it. But this place, it was no Musso's. It was a forgettable Italian spot on Wilshire called Michelangelo's. Richard had never heard of it. There wasn't even a valet. Inside, there was no Warren Beatty, nor anybody else, aside from some waiters, a bartender leaning over the want ads of the Sunday Los Angeles Times, and Gleb Cooper in a booth. He almost did not recognize him, because it was the first time he had ever seen him not wearing a suit. He almost did not even see him at all. He had chosen a booth in the corner, in the shadows. He had his head down, reading the paper, a golf hat pulled low. How old was Gleb? Richard could only guess. He had been a ubiquitous presence in Hollywood longer than anyone could remember. But he still maintained the vitality and power of a man Richard's age. He always wore custom suits. He was the one who first encouraged Richard to put more effort and consideration into what he wore. Dressing well is a way of showing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.